Good morning, everyone. So nice to see you again today. So, okay, just I would like to start with a short recap of what of the last part of the yesterday lecture. So yesterday I started talking about regularity or alpha harmonic maps, and into a general manifold. I said that this was a result that I proved with Riviera in 2011. Then there have been, as I said, several extensions and variation of the problem. And also in more recently, what I did with Alessandro Pigatti was to consider the case of alpha harmonic maps defined not anymore on the circle, but on the boundary of general surface, like for instance, an annuli type surface. But in this paper, we could prove a higher regularity of alpha harmonic map. Okay, so I said that this regularity comes from a result concerning what I call Schrödinger type non-local system with an anti-symmetric potential. So what we showed is the following, said that if you have an L2 solution of this system in R in a distributional sense, then you can prove that actually your solution is in LP log for any P bigger or equal than one. So the key point is, first of all, try to see why we can deduce the regularity of alpha harmonic maps from this result. So our goal was actually to try to rewrite the Euler-Lagrange equation for harmonic maps in a way that you make appear an anti-symmetric potential. So yesterday, I started by saying that, okay, I know that alpha harmonic mass means that the Laplacian 1 over alpha of U is perpendicular to the to the manifold, so so it coincides with its normal projection. And so what I did it is to rewrite the Laplacian 1 over 2 simply like Laplacian 1 over 4 of the Laplacian 1 over 4 of your U. That you will see that this quantity will play the role of in the framework of anti-symmetric systems. So I did is let's try to split this quantity here in two parts. So the tangential part and the normal part. So, and I said that unfortunately in this framework, you don't have, first of all, I said that in general, you don't have that this quantity here is equal to zero. It's not true in general. And moreover, you cannot differentiate by part. The Leibniz rule does not hold. And these are the main issues when you are dealing with non-local stuff. So there are these two issues. And what I said yesterday is that since you don't have in general equality here, I call, so this is the beginning of the lecture today. So I call the error of the missing product rule H1 over alpha and defined in this way. You can, it's an easy exercise also to see that you can express this operator, this commutator, I call commutator with three terms, in an integral form. And okay, so I said we could prove actually that this operator satisfies a sort of integrability by compensation result, because if you assume that, as I said yesterday, if you assume simply that Laplacian 1 over 4 and Laplacian one over 4 of B is in null 2, you don't see right away which kind of regularity you have here. It's you don't see anything, but we could prove that this regularity result, that Laplacian 1 over 4 of this commutator is even in the RD space, not only in L1, but even in the RD space. And you have this in this uniform estimate. Okay, so now let's see how we can use this. So, and actually I have to say that in this context, the key point was the presence of these commutators that permit us to get the regularity. So what I'm going to show you is to estimate these two, these two parts. So first of all, we want to estimate this part here and this part here. For the moment, we ignore the normal projection, the Laplacian 1 over 4. We ignore it. So we don't care about this. So we just consider this. And how can we estimate this part? We simply multiply by a test function and we integrate. So by integrating against a test function, what you do, okay, use the fact that, so you see, Pn, I told already, yes, is a symmetric function, so you can put here. And then use a sort of integration by Plancherel theorem, in the sense that you can put, so maybe I can show you. So first of all, you can, okay, you get Pt Laplacian 1 over 4 of U, and then you have Pn phi, and then you can put this Laplacian 1 over 4 in front of this one. So you can put here, and you obtain simply, here, and you have this situation again. Pt is symmetric, and you put on in front of the test function. So you get simply that this quantity here is just Laplacian 1 over 4 of U multiplied by this quantity in blue. And then, okay, what you do, you try to make appear this famous commutator. And actually, you add, subtract what it needs in order to add this commutator. So you just add and subtract this quantity. And here you can simply subtract this one because it's zero. Why it is zero? Because the two metrics are orthogonal. So the Laplacian, something which is zero, is zero. And finally, you have to believe me that you get something like that. So you have Laplacian 1 over 4 here, which multiply this quantity here, and minus, again, Laplacian 1 over 4, which multiply this commutator. So by putting together, you can write that actually the part that I wanted to estimate is can be rewritten in this way, is just Laplacian 1 over 4 multiplied by this quantity, which is a potential, plus a rest. The rest, for the moment, you don't care. The rest luckily satisfy good properties, a good operator, because it is it comes from this famous commutator that satisfies suitable good assumptions. Okay, so but now how we can go on? So the idea was, okay, so look at this, it's not anti-symmetric. Let's try to transform our equation in such a way that on the right-hand side, you have an anti-symmetric potential. So how you do this? You add, so what you do, you subtract the symmetric part of this quantity here. And by subtracting the symmetric part of this quantity here, you just get this. Okay, you have to believe me. And then if you put everything together, you get that the Laplacian 1 over 2 of u is equal to an anti-symmetric potential omega multiplied by the Laplacian 1 over 4 of u plus a rest. A rest, this one is good because I said satisfy nice property, but it remains two quantities here. So you see, it's something that, so once this part comes from the decomposition of Laplacian 1 over 4 in the tangential and the normal part, this one, and this one, it's coming from the fact that we add here, we subtract here the anti-symmetric part of this quantity. So if we subtract, you have to add, so you get this quantity, which is not zero, as I said. But what is the good news? The good news is that, okay, as I said, this is not zero, but we have good estimate for the normal, projection, the Laplacian 1 over 4. So you can maybe right away observe the following. It's clear that this quantity here is in L2. Why? Because by assumption, this quantity is in L2, and this is in infinity because our projections are bounded. And in particular, you can estimate the L2 norm of this stuff here by the L infinity norm of this multiplied by the L2 norm of u. This is a trivial, but it's not good in our, if you get a regularity, this is not a good estimate. And actually we use the commutator again that permit us to get better estimate this term, which was also the key point in our stuff. So what you do is, okay, you write this quantity here in an integral form. So use that Laplacian 1 over 4 is just the principal value. For the moment, I omit the fact that it is a principal value in the principal value sense. And you rewrite the Laplacian 1 over 4 like the integral of this quantity here is 3 over 2. And so this does not depend on y, so I can put inside this one. But then what I do is rewrite, so you know that u belongs to your manifolds, so coincide with its projection. So it's big, you know, I recall you that the nearest point projection is the function that to any point in the neighborhood of your manifold associated the nearest point on the manifold. So if the point belongs to the manifold, the projection is the point itself. So I can rewrite these two quantities just Pn of y, u of x, Pn u of y. And then I used the Taylor development of this projection. And I recall you that the differential of your projection at the point u of x is equal exactly pt u of x. We saw in the second lecture this. And so I have the right to rewrite this quantity in this way. So it is equal Pn u of x that multiply this quantity here. But then I realized that if I multiply by Pn, Pn and Pt are orthogonal. So this disappears. So I discovered that actually this quantity here as a sort of quadratic growth, in the sense that you have that Pn u of x multiplied by ux minus uy is less than the square of the difference between ux and uy. And this permits us to estimate this quantity here in terms of the famous commutator, because I said that there is also an integral formulation of this commutator, which is this one. And you realize that when u is equal to b, you get exactly what I have just written now. So I have to, where is this one? Okay, this one. And then because of the estimate that we got for this quantity here, I can say that actually the L2 norm of this is less than the L2 norm of this, and the L2 norm of this can be estimated by this one, by the product of the L2 norm of this multiplied by itself. So I can write maybe like this, which is a better in this framework, is this the estimate we wanted to get. And actually we can even do even better, in the sense that we can even replace this L2 norm by the L2 infinity norm, which is less than the previous one. That is not the point that I want to, it's not a big deal now. Okay, so we found actually that our harmonic map satisfies something which is a system of with an anti-symmetric potential plus a good rest. A rest that satisfies, is an operator that when you apply this operator to a given test function, this can be estimated in the right way. And so in some sense we can, that's why we can apply this result. We can, because if you set V equal Laplacian 1 over 4 of U, which is in L2, we have discovered that actually this V satisfy a system of this type. There is a rest, clearly. But that's not, okay, it's a sort of technique, okay, further technicalities, but for the moment, I prefer to concentrate the case where there is not a rest. And I want to explain you how we got regularity for such kind of systems. Okay, so how we can exploit the anti-symmetry in this case. So the idea was, okay, let's try to make, as I told you yesterday, for the local case, a change of variable. And so instead of considering your solution V, you multiply V by a rotation Okay, the advantage of a rotation is that they are bounded, and this is a, so a compass, the space of rotation as a compact, a compactly group, and so it's a good he helps in this regularity theory. So we try to see which kind of equation satisfies this new variable. And okay, it's clear that in this case, if you want to compute the equation satisfied by this term, it's clear that you cannot integrate, you cannot apply Leibniz rule, but clearly our idea was actually to make appear in some way the commutator. So we start by writing this, so PV, so minus, so we wrote Laplacian 1 over 4P of V minus Laplacian 1 over 4P of V, and that, but you have actually to add the terms that you subtract, and so, and then you use the fact that here, this quantity here satisfy this equation. And so it's easy to see that actually this new variable satisfy a new system where the potential here is this one, this blue one. And if you remember yesterday, in the local stuff, in the local Schrödinger equations, what we got is the quantity in blue was something that we wanted to make divergent free. So remember yesterday, instead of Laplacian 1 over 4, we had the gradient of p multiplied by p minus 1, and we wanted by a suitable perturbation argument find a matrix which was invertible such that this quantity here was divergent free. But in this case, what replaced the notion divergent free in this context? So actually, there is no hope, first of all, to find P in such a way this is zero. In general, it's not possible. But the idea was the following. So again, we want to choose what it is called a good gauge, so a good rotation, such that this quantity, so such that the antisymmetric part of this quantity absorb this potential. So actually, we can prove that under smallness condition on this L2 norm, so under the assumption that the L2 norm of omega is small, you can find rotation P satisfy this equality here. In some sense, the antisymmetric part of this quantity here, which is defined by 1 over 2, this quantity minus its transpose, absorb this potential omega. But then you realize that, you say, okay, it remains when you make the difference of these two quantity here, it remains the symmetric part of this stuff here. And actually, with the previous choice of your P, actually, you have the right estimate in the sense that your P that you find satisfy that the Laplacian 1 over 4 of P in L2 is estimated by the L2 norm of L2, so it's small also as well. You reduce actually by this change of variable, this system here as a system, so in this new variable, where you have a new potential, and some a rest, which is good as I will show you. So I want also to mention that clearly the determination of this P is not so easy. It requires quite a lot of work. It's not, and there are two different proofs. A proof that we gave in 2011 by using some approximation argument and implicit function theorem. But there is also the possibility of recently Armin Shikora with Katarzyna Mazowieska, they show the possibility to determine P by variational method. Okay, so you have this and then you realize that luckily the new potential here in blue has a better regularity. Namely, we discovered that the Laplacian 1 over 4 is in the RG space. And even also the other commutator is a good one, is in H minus 1 of R. And in particular, there's a remark, is just that this new commutator here is just the adjoint of the previous one multiplied so is the adjoint on the Laplacian 1 over 4 of the H 1 over 4, so just remark, but the key point is not only that belongs the blue space, but you have a good estimate in the sense that the RD norm of this this quantity here is less than the Laplacian 104 of P to the power 2, and also you have a good estimate for this one. But then when you have this property here, you use another a sharp Sobolev embedding, says that if function f is in H1, so in the RD space, then Laplacian minus 1 over 4 of this function is in L2-1, which is a better, as I said, this space is the Lorentz space and is contained in L2. It's a better space, and in particular, you get this information here. You get that actually your new potential is not only in L2, but it is in L2-1. And therefore, we are reduced to study a system for the new variable, such that on the right-hand side, you have a potential omega tilde, which is in L2-1, plus a good rest. And I want to stress that omega tilde is not necessarily anti-symmetric, just L2-1. And then you can ask why it is better L2-1. And actually, when you have a system like that, you can prove directly without a change of variable that if you have a solution of this system, you get directly that W is in this space, LQ log. So directly means that it does not mean that it's easy, quite, super easy, but just to say that you don't need this change or gauge like in the previous case. And by the way, I want to give you also an exercise for you, just coming back to the local case, you have the same property. Actually, if you have a solution of this system, where you have the Laplacian here, and the right-hand side is a potential, which is in W11, in particular in L2-1 by Sobolev embedding, you get right away that the gradient is in Q log for some Q bigger than 2, and then you can prove that it is for any Q. So this is an exercise. Maybe I will show you the idea to in the no local case. Actually, the local case is easier in the sense that the key point you can always multiply by cutoff function, integrate gradient per part, and so on. So I want to show you an idea of the proof because of this result here. So why I wanted to give a proof, because I have to say that when work on non-local stuff, actually the delocalization property represent one of the most technical nuisance. So it's not so immediate. So yeah, it's quite technical. So I want to show you actually what you get in general in this context. So the idea proof is the following. So we want to show first a Mori type estimate for W of the 4D L2 infinity norm. In general, in the local case, what you want to get in order to have the C0 alpha regularity of your solution is to have such kind of Mori type estimate where here you have the L2 norm of the gradient of your solution, which I call in general, you have this in the local framework. And here I want to have this. Why? So we can ask, why do you consider the L2 infinity norm of W instead of L2 norm? And the idea, the answer is the following. It in natural comes from the equation itself. Because I give you the heuristics here, you can express your solution W as the Laplacian minus 1/4 of the Laplacian 1/4 of this itself. And then I use the fact that there is this representation, so that it's the inverse Fourier transform of the multiplier associated to this operator here, multiplied by the Fourier transform of Laplacian 1/4 omega. And you know that this is equal just the convolution of the inverse Fourier transform of this operator, which is equal always to x to the power minus 1/2, and with the convolution with this Laplacian 1/4, which is this. And then so the information that you have is that this kernel here is not in L2, but it is in L2 infinity. And then you use some the convolution property for the Lorentz spaces, and you get actually that the convolution between a L2 function, L2 infinity function, which is this one, with the L1 function is in L2 infinity. So I can estimate the L2 infinity norm or W by the L2 infinity norm of your kernel by the L1 norm of this quantity here, but then I use the duality between L2-1 and L2 infinity, and this is the key point where the L2-1 enters. So and the L2-1 L2 infinity norm enters, because here I can I can majorize this by this quantity here. So in particular, this inequality says that if the L2 norm is small enough, then you can put this on the left-hand side, you can absorb this term on the left-hand side, and you get this is zero, and then W is zero. And this is what we call a bootstrap test that suggests us that there are decreased energy estimate of this type. And this is in general when you, in this context, when you want to prove, for instance, this is the Hölder regular or some energy estimate, you first try to check if this bootstrap test works. So in the sense that you don't need to localize, you just make the estimate directly by considering the equation and by assuming that some quantity are small. If you get that your solution is zero, then this suggests that this estimate exists. And actually, what is the idea in this in this case, what you do, okay, if it is not small in your R, you localize, so you just consider a capital R such that for any X, you have, so for any epsilon zero, you can find a capital R for which you add this quantity by the absolutely continuity. And then the idea is, but people were working on local PDEs knows that this is the typical strategy. So to split, the idea was to split your potential in two parts, one part which is supporting in a small ball and the other part outside. And the part which is outside the ball, you express as the sum of a function supported in dyadic annuli. And then, you write again W as the Laplacian minus 1/4 of the part supported on the on the ball and the part supported in annuli. And it's okay. I wrote the estimates, but it's what you get finally is that the L to infinity norm of your solution W in a small ball is estimate by the L to infinity norm in a slightly bigger ball, and even you can okay in a slightly bigger ball plus an infinite series which converges because you have this crushing term. And you can by this, by iterating this this inequality by considering smaller radius, get actually that you have this this energy estimate. But this energy estimate, why it is useful? Because you can inject this into the equation and you get right away, because you know that so W W is Laplacian 1/4 of W is equal to omega tilde W. So since you have this estimate here, you by plugging this estimate here, you get actually that the L1 norm of your solution, so the L1 norm of the Laplacian 1/4 the solution satisfy again the such estimate. In other way, it's this quantity here is called fractional maximal function. So the maximal function is bounded, but then you can use some refined rate potential estimate on this maximal function, and this is one excellent reference. You get that point-wise, you can majorize your solution W by this one. But then this one, you can prove that because you have W14, W is in L1, you can prove that, okay, can prove it's classical to say that the maximal function is in this weak space. And so this belongs also to this weak space, and this implies that W belongs to LP log for any P between in this interval, but also it is by bootstrapping you can get also for any P. So it was, I wanted just to give you the idea how things works in this framework. It's clear that the difficulties that we have not in general a system like that. We have also a rest we have to deal. And so you have to keep in mind several things. But the basic idea is this one. Okay, so I want maybe to, I want also to mention that, as I told you, so this theory started 10 years ago. So there have been, it's clear that when you started theory, actually the first time the way we wrote the harmonic map equation at the beginning was with value into the sphere, and it was not like that. We did in a different way, but it was the paper where actually we discovered these commutators. But then there have been a lot of progresses. In particular, I have to say Armin Shikora also did a lot in this framework. And I would like to mention is a recent result, a nice result with Tarzina Mazowieczka, because they succeeding formulated the harmonic alpha harmonic equations, not only alpha harmonic map equation, but also in general S harmonic map equation, but here we concentrate to the case S is equal 1/2 in terms of a fractional gradient and fractional divergence. So I don't know if the notion of fractional gradient coincide with the one that we were talking about yesterday, end of the last talk, but this is the idea. So given a map U from R to R, so I give the definition when U is defined in R, but you can the definition that they give is also for Rn, and they associate this fractional gradient, which is a vector field, okay, and correspond to this fractional gradient, they introduce a fractional divergence. So the fractional divergence of a vector field F, which is measurable with respect to this weighted measure, is the operator which is defined in this way. So when you test with any function phi, you consider inside the integral actually the fractional gradient of phi. So this is the operator that acts in this way for any phi C infinity with compass support. And they were succeeded formulating a sort of what I call a fractional rent inequality, in the sense that they proved that if you have the product of a vector field, which is divergent phi in this fractional sense, with a fractional gradient, where the product is defined in this way, then they can prove, as in the local case, that this is in the RG space. And okay, so actually they were able, so I just wanted to make you observe that if you apply the divergent 1 over 2 to this fractional gradient, you get again the Laplacian 1 over 2 because of this relation, but they could reformulate, okay, first of all, the alpha harmonic mapping with value into the sphere, in this way, namely, okay, they, in the case of the sphere, they refined the formulation that I show at the beginning, where here it's a sort of Lagrange multiply, and but in the before the formulation there was U multiplied by this stuff. And this, they recall this stuff as a gradient, a fractional gradient. So it plays the role in the local frame of the gradient of U square. And they prove actually that this function, this equation here is equivalent to the fact that this quantity here, so this potential here is divergent free in the fractional sense. So they discover a conservation law, and also in the case of general smooth manifold, they reformulate the equation in this form. So the equation becomes yeah, so in the general frame is becomes like again, okay, on the left hand side you have Laplacian 1 over 2, and the right hand side you have a potential which is anti-symmetric, plus instead of the Laplacian 1 over 4, you have this one. And actually, in their context, they perform again a change of variables, and what they prove, they find a change of variable that permit to transform the system in another one where this the new potential that appears is divergent free, in order to apply the previous result. So it's a nice formulation. I have to say that I think both formulations are nice, and maybe for some formulation you can maybe get, I don't, for instance, we use the student here, use this formulation for to obtain some Poiseuille type inequalities. So they are another way to see things. The key point is that this, I have this fractional Wente inequality is also based on this commutator estimate. Okay, so I want to just to remark that this commutator estimate, there are several ways to prove this. One way is by using potential theory, one a little Rupalis decomposition, that this is the method that we use at the beginning, but also recently Shikora and Lensman succeeded in getting such estimate by using the extension theory, so by considering the harmonic extension. So each method has its advantage and disadvantage. So, okay, so do I have still a little bit time or not? No? I have time, Marina?
I thought I was unmuted. Yeah, you started a little bit late, so I think...
I just conclude quickly. Okay, so yeah. I want just to tell you that this harmonic maps is not something which has only an analytical interest, and actually we discovered that not only us, but a lot of people, a lot of connection with some geometrical problems. For instance, the first application is the connection between these maps and the free boundary minimal disk. At the beginning of the course, I show you a picture where I don't know, you know, it's too much. Okay, yeah. I show this equatorial disk, the idea to find the minimal surfaces that cut the boundary, in this case of the ball, in an orthogonal sense. So I show you the example of the disk, the case where the domain is the disk, or a disk or a surface which is conformally equivalent to the disk. And then I mention also the fact that there is this problem when you have the domain is not as another topology, like an annular type domain. So you have this example, okay? So there is this connection actually between, we discovered this connection between alpha harmonic maps and this kind of problems. So I hope to find what is here. And actually we showed that, okay, this result, the proof of the result is in the joint paper with Luca Martinazzi and Riviera. You can find also proof in the paper by me, Vincent Mieux, Yannick Sir. And we prove also with Alessandro Pigatti in a general, in the case of general surfaces, so also for annular type surfaces. And we prove actually that if you consider an alpha harmonic map, then its harmonic extension is conformal, and the normal derivative here is normal to the manifold itself. So I say here, so U is a minimal disk, so the extension is a minimal disk, so minimize the area functional whose boundary lies in this support manifolds and meets this support manifold in an orthogonal way. And okay, this permit us to give a characterization of such harmonic maps. For instance, in the case where you have harmonic maps defined on S1 with value in S1, this coincides and of degree one, this coincides with the group of Möbius transformation of the disk. Okay, there are other, so I put some sketch of proof, but that you can look at if you are interested. And there are other applications. So one is related to the so-called Steklov eigenvalue problem, which is what is this problem is you take the first eigenvalue associated to the Dirichlet to Neumann map. So you know that you take a function u, you take a function u, you take a function u which is defined, for instance, which is in H1 half on S1, and what you do, you take the normal derivative of its harmonic extension. What you do is this operator that I call L, all of you, is this operator is a self-adjoint operator, and you just consider the eigenvalue associated to this one, okay? The lambda for which L u is equal to u, right? But okay, but the idea is that, okay, if you take S1, you start from the disk, and what you do, you put on the disk a metric G, which is conformal equivalent to the Euclidean metric, namely you take E to lambda D x square. So the idea is, in general, for any metric, you have a new operator. So you just consider the derivative with respect to this metric. And then again, you have the dependence of this eigenvalue from this metric. And then the Steklov problem is that you want to maximize along all this conformal metric, this the first eigenvalue associated to this problem, and then you multiply by a normalization constant which corresponds to the length of the sphere respect. So you maximize this, and you find a G star, LG star, and you can prove actually, you can prove, okay, it's not very sure that the eigen eigenfunction associated to this first eigenvalue, the components are minimal disk, free boundary minimal disk, so they are half harmonic maps. So there is this connection. Then I like very much also the the Mio and Sira. They show the, they prove the convergence of the fractional Gibbs-Bullandau equation, which is this one, and they show that the limit where epsilon goes to zero, you convert to an alpha harmonic map. Then there are also other applications investigated by Shikora, Wright, Blatter. But I know better this problem, so it's I like this this result. So because show the connection, so they establish a connection which this non-local non-local Gibbs-Bullandau equation to alpha harmonic maps in the spirit what have been done in the local case for local Gibbs-Bullandau equations. So I think I finished. So before giving you the my slides, I will also write at the end a list of the main references which are related to the topics that I have presented during this course. So I think I have finished.